So today I intend dealing with a different kind of a proposition wherein we will examine the stages which are there in relation to a crime. You see, how many of you have seen a rocket being fired, for instance? If I could, you know, draw a simile, let us consider as if an ICBM is going to be fired from India to China, say. Now, first and foremost, there are stages in relation to that. I am just trying to draw a kind of a parallel. First and foremost is this thought that there can be a device which can be fired from one country to another during times of war. So that thought is the thought of an ICBM, an intercontinental ballistic missile, as they call it, or simply put, a rocket. Now, that is the first part, that in your mind you have thought about a rocket which can be fired from one country to another. Now comes the part that you now start preparing for it, how to make a rocket. So that involves the mathematical calculations, the collection of material in order to assemble it, to get hold of propellant in order to propel it, and then starts the assembly. It starts getting assembled, and the picture which you normally people associate with the firing of a rocket, every time we have seen, whenever a launch of a satellite happens, like in Thumba. Thumba is a place from where satellites are launched. There's a rocket launching station. So there you find that it is placed vertically and with a pointed head, then there is a bottom. And then subsequent to that, as you see, even in, the festival of Diwali, rocket preparations, you get hold of a bottle and you place the rocket there, right? So you have thought, even there, if you go to a more simpler example, that to fire a rocket during the course of Diwali. So you think in your mind, yes, I have got to go and buy this rocket, and this rocket will be placed in a bottle and it will get fired. Then you get out of the bottle, you buy the rocket from the bazaar and you place it inside. Now comes a part in the ICBM when the switch is put on and the count starts, which you people are aware of, 10, 9, 8, 7 it goes, and then at 0 the rocket fires. Now this entire stages of a crime is just like this. Now it will be a little simpler when we understand it. So the first portion, which I spoke of, where we decided that yes, we must build something which can go intercontinental without a man going across a territory, let it be a machine which gets fired from a territory to reach another territory. That stage is the first stage in a crime, which is called intention. I have dealt with intention on many occasions. We discussed this entire portion when we did a chapter in relation to Manjriya. So this is the first stage. The first stage is that of intention. But the question is that is intention punishable? Is it culpable? The answer is, because in the equation that we spoke of, the crime equation said that there has to be a consensus of two things. One, a guilty mind with actus reus. Mens rea with actus reus in the crime equation will amount to a crime. So intention alone will not be punishable. I may have any intention, I may nurse any intention in my mind. My intention could be to kill, say, Saurabh Soni. In my mind I have this. So I can see him. So therefore I say that I have this in my mind. But this very intention alone is not enough. So long as I nurse an intention, till that point of time it is okay. I go around nursing that intention, no issue. As I had explained earlier, The moment that intention gets expressed in terms of word or deed, then it attains culpability. So in relation to the first stage of crime, which is intention, which is a necessary element, but not culpable. Now, so therefore, in relation to the commission of an offense, I said that these are stages. So four, like the rocket that I explained, the launching of a rocket that I explained, there are four stages. You could understand it in this way. There are four stages towards the commission of an offense. The first stage is intention, as I said. The second is preparation, which I will deal with when I spoke in terms of acquiring material, making mathematical calculations, getting the propellant, all preparation. The second stage is preparation. The third is an attempt. The third is an attempt means a progress towards the commission of the offense. So where you reach the stage of an attempt. Now when the attempt is successful, you have tried and you succeed, then the successfulness of the attempt comes the fourth stage, which is accomplishment. At that point of time, the offense is completed. That particular offense has been committed. Supposing that last stage of accomplishment is not arrived at, then it would just be an attempt. Now, having said this about the stages of a crime, the question is that where all will culpability be affixed in relation to these stages? This also I will demonstrate and illustrate as I go a little further. The question is that attempt also has been made punishable. Most of you know, if you have seen the Indian Penal Code, there is a provision 511 which talks about attempt. Interestingly, 511 also does not have a definition. It does not define what an attempt is. But it says that an attempt is punishable. We will read 511 also when we go down a little further. So the question is that attempt is punishable. Why is attempt punishable is the basic question which will arise. Because the offense has not been committed. You may ask this question logically, that the offense is not being committed, yet I am being punished for it. What could be the rationale? What is the reasoning? The rationale for this is that what does an attempt do? The attempt in relation to carrying out of any offense creates an alarm in the mind of the person who is affected by the attempt. I tried to shoot you, but I have not succeeded. I fired a pistol at you, or I tried to stab you, you moved aside. I was unsuccessful in my attempt to do it, to complete the offense. But I created an alarm in your mind of injury. I created an alarm. You got scared. It's an indescribable feeling, but it does happen. So that alarm in itself is injury. That alarm which is created in your mind is injury. And because of that injury, attempt becomes punishable. The rationale behind making attempt punishable is this alarm that it induces or this alarm that it causes. The moral guilt which is associated with an attempt, as far as the perspective of the accused is concerned, is the same. The moral perspective is the same. I tried to fire at you. The moral guilt which I have is the same, whether the bullet strikes you or it does not. So therefore, the moral guilt being the same and injury being caused by way of an alarm makes attempt culpable and punishable. Now, from the stage of intention, which I just spoke of, because I had qualified that intention is not punishable. Why is intention not punishable? You must always keep asking these questions. In order to find the answer, you need to ask the right question. Attempt is punishable. Why is it punishable? I answered it. Why is intention not punishable? Intention is not punishable because of a very simple thing. There is an old saying which says that even the devil cannot make out what is going on in the mind of a man. If the devil cannot make out what is going out in the mind of a man, how do you expect the prosecution to prove what is going on in your mind? So therefore, intention is not punishable, because it is literally impossible for the prosecution to prove what is going on in the mind of anybody. Maybe we have guilty intentions, but it is literally impossible for the prosecution to prove that this was the intention that the man was nursing at this point of time. So therefore, intention is not made punishable. But the moment, as I had said, it is expressed, because in a lecture which I had dealt with earlier, I had said that there is no direct evidence which is possible. What is possible is the circumstances which lead us to the inference that this was the intention. So when that is the scenario, that circumstances would be by word or by deed. If anything is expressed in terms of that intention by word or deed, we will be in a position to deduce that this was the intention of the person, and therefore this will become inculpable. What is the example of that? Let us see a commonplace example from the penal code. Come to the offense of conspiracy. Right? What does conspiracy say? Conspiracy essentially makes it punishable when there is an agreement to do an illegal act or to do a legal act by illegal means. The agreement itself is punishable. But so long as it is just an agreement, because you go to the explanation says that something more needs to be done to evidence the fact that there was an agreement of mind. So here is an offense where the agreement or the meeting of minds is punishable, but the evidence of that you find from some kind of an act or actus reus which has been done. So what is punishable is the intention in that case. Though perceive there is intention between each other and there is no act which has been done by any of our party as such, you are unable to deduce that there was an agreement. Now I go to the next aspect in relation to the stages of a crime, and the next aspect is that of preparation. That part which I had dealt with in relation to the making of an ICBM, that intention was there. Now I go a little further. I start collecting material. Right? I have started collecting material. The question is that whether this preparation in itself, would that be punishable? This is the second poser. Now, even as far as preparation is concerned, now this is a very interesting concept. Preparation also has not been made culpable. It is not culpable, because in order to go to the next stage from where culpability starts, because culpability will be starting from the stage of attempt, preparation itself will not be punishable. So again, the basic question needs to be asked, why is preparation not punishable? When that basic question is asked, the answer again is this, that preparation maybe. Now let me illustrate. I don't like Shadab. Okay? In my mind, he has done so many things against me. So I nurse some ill will against him. And I decide that, look, as far as Shadab is concerned, I need to teach him a lesson. And I buy a pistol with that purpose. I buy a pistol, a licensed firearm, and I load that licensed firearm, right? And I keep that firearm in my pocket. The intention is there, the preparation has been done. I have kept the firearm in my pocket. I am ready. But I stop at that. I don't do anything further. Shadab comes, talks. I can see him coming from a long distance. He's a tall man. My weapon is ready. I can even shoot from a distance. It can go over the head of Saurabh Soni and others who stand at that gate number 7 and hit him. But I don't. Have I committed an offense? The answer is no. So what is the reason? The reason is this, that the prosecution cannot definitely say that I bought that pistol and I kept it in my pocket only with this purpose of shooting him. I could have done it with the purpose of defending myself. I bought a firearm to defend myself and I kept it loaded. He is, after all, a man who comes from Vasipur. You never know what he can do. He may fire at me. So I should be ready. So I kept it for that purpose. So the prosecution is unable to prove out here that what would be the purpose of that preparation. That is one aspect of it. When I started with this aspect, I said that it has another very interesting facet to it. And that interesting facet is this, in terms of why the law doesn't punish preparation, is that the law accords an opportunity. It accords an opportunity to the accused. That if you can repent for your action, you are allowed to repent. That there can be a change of mind. It factors in that change of mind. Right? I come with the preparation of doing it, but I have a change of mind. I decide not to do it. So the offense is not complete. When the offense is not complete, or that step has not been taken, the law gives that opportunity for the person to be penitent, to repent for his action, and therefore does not make it punishable. It gives that period, that time. Now I will give specific examples to you to illustrate what I am saying and to show how preparation has not been made culpable. Now this has got a specific term legally, and that specific term for this, what I was stating in terms of penitence, is a word called locus poenitentiae, which means the time to give, to repent, to think of an alternative course of action. And that is also one of the reasons why prosecution will not take place, because the mind can change, the course of action can change. Now to illustrate, let us come to some of the decided cases on this issue, which throws light on the subject. The first case that comes to my mind is an English case, and this case related to that of a jeweler. Jewelers from time immemorial have been looked in askance for their conduct. They have been considered to be mischievous. My clerk also happens to be a jeweler, that apart. So this jeweler in England, what he did, it struck upon him that here is a brilliant plan. I have insured my goods. So why shouldn't I call the police and say that part of my goods have got burgled? So he rings up the police and tells them that, you know, this much amount of jewelry, last night when I came back, I found that there was a burglary which was committed in my shop. And this much amount of jewelry which was there is found to be missing. The idea was that once the police complaint is lodged, then on the basis of that complaint, he intended to file a claim with the insurance company seeking compensation. Now the police came and they investigated. And on investigations, they came to the finding that no theft had happened. There was no burglary in the shop and no theft happened. Now here came up the question that whether the man was guilty of an offense. The finding was that till such time, because here he had made preparations in terms of, you know, calling the police and telling them that there was burglary in his shop. But he stopped at that because he called the police, there was an intervention. There is an intervention before the commission of an attempt or the commission of an offense. Because his intention thereafter was to fill up the said form and ask for compensation. The filling up of the said form had not taken place. And neither a claim had been filed with the insurance company. So long as that had not been done, it was at the stage of preparation and there was no offense. Now the ruling is, as far as the ruling is concerned, those of you who would be interested, I will give you the ruling. The ruling is, R versus Robinson, 1915, 2 Kings Bench, page 342. Going from here, I come to one of the interesting matters which came up before the Honorable Supreme Court, in a matter which came up from Punjab. And in that, what had happened was that there was, at that point of time, a local law which was enacted in Punjab which prohibited the export of paddy from the state of Punjab without a license to any other state. Now, from Punjab, there was a truck which was loaded with rice, and that truck on its way to Delhi was stopped at Smalka. Smalka is a small town in between, which is around 15 kilometers away from Delhi, 15 to 30 kilometers away from Delhi. The truck was stopped there, and on a search of the truck, they found that it was loaded with sacks of paddy. Now the question that arose was that was there an attempt in relation to violate the rule which had been promulgated locally in relation to the export of paddy by bringing it into the state of Delhi. Now, while considering this question, the Supreme Court interestingly evolved a very interesting test, because the reason is that the line between preparation and attempt, that discerning line is very thin. You cannot really come to an objective analysis that here preparation stops and from here on attempt begins. How to bring that distinction? Now this is the difficulty which most courts over a period of time have grappled with. That there is no objective criteria. So what are those tests? So again and again, they keep drawing tests which keep evolving over a period of time. And this test in this case, which is called State of Punjab versus Malkiyat Singh, was evolved by Justice Ramaswamy. And this test was an interesting test. And what did this test say? This test said that the difference or the discerning line would be that if a particular series of acts have been committed, are being committed, and during the course of the commission of the act, there is some supervening factor which comes and intercedes in between, which stops the commission of the acts any further. The test is that all those acts which were committed till that point of time, if they were to be seen, if all those acts happen to be harmless, then in that kind of a scenario, the offense will not be completed. It will be still at the stage of preparation and not that of an attempt. For instance, if it was only intention, that could be gathered. Now, in this case, what had happened? In this case, 30 miles or 15 miles were yet to be traveled to Delhi. It is only when the truck went past Delhi, one could say that the offense was completed. The truck had not gone past. There was a possibility that somebody would have told the driver in between that don't go past the border because you will violate the offense. So he could have changed his mind and turned back. So therefore, when stopped at that point of time, there was this opportunity for him to change his course, change his mind. If that opportunity was there to change his mind, then in that kind of a scenario, it will be an offense which is only till the stage of a preparation. It will not be to the stage of an attempt or a commission. And preparation, as I told you, is no offense. But this test was an interesting test which was evolved to look at it from a different angle. Now, when we move into the topic of attempt later on, we will find in relation to that, there are various angles and there are various dimensions which I will discuss. And those dimensions will show how this definition in terms of preparation and attempt over a period of time has been evolving. How different kinds of dimensions have visited this problem. Now take for example another case. This happened in the 1950s. The citation I will give, it is by the term of Noor Bibi versus State of Jammu and Kashmir. Now Jammu and Kashmir, you know, like Punjab and Rajasthan, these are states which share a border with Pakistan. Now as far as Jammu and Kashmir is concerned, Jammu and Kashmir not only shares a border with Pakistan, but due to the conflict which arose between India and Pakistan, Kashmir also got divided between Pak-occupied Kashmir and Indian Kashmir. Now, in this kind of a scenario, people on this side of the border have relatives on that side of the border. Overnight, they got separated and they have ties, familial ties. So, obviously, when they have familial ties, you have your brother on the other side or you have your sister on the other side because their line got drawn overnight because of a conflict. Your biological relations don't get erased. So therefore, at some point of time, there is an urge that you feel like meeting your brother or you feel like meeting your sister. And you forget that there is a line in between. Now, Noor Bibi, a similar kind of a situation happened. And she decided on herself that she wants to visit her relatives who are just across the border, which is a river or which is a bridge. You, for instance, stay in your colonies, you cross a road. Tomorrow it is said that no, that side of the road is something else. But you know what is there. You have been there so many times. So that urge will be there that why shouldn't I try? So Noor Bibi one day decided that I want to go and meet my sister or I want to go and meet my brother. And she started walking towards the border. Now when she started walking towards the border, just before she could cross, she was arrested. They caught her. I said, Bibi, what are you up to? And you are going about to cross the border. You are crossing the border. So she said, no, I am not crossing the border. I have just moved till the border. The court looked into that issue and said that look, not everybody who is going towards the border may necessarily be wanting to cross it. It could be this that she went up to the fence and from there her sister or her brother came up to the fence of that side. And both from their sides of the fences decided to talk to each other. Would that be an offense? So this could be a preparation at the most. There was an intention to cross the border. There was a preparation in the sense that she moved towards the border. But there was a change of mind when she found that her sister from the other side had also moved and had reached the border, she could see her. And she felt satisfied and they both wanted to talk to each other. They exchanged words. They said salam alaikum this side and walaikum salam the other side, whatever. And they were satisfied. So in that kind of a scenario, the offense was not completed. It was only in preparation. And therefore, the court said that no offense is made out as far as preparation is concerned and she should be acquitted. So these are the cases which I have illustrated over a period of time, that this is a fine line of distinction. There are a series of acts which go to the commission of an offense. Now the fine distinction, in a way, one of the distinctions which has been drawn and where there are differences which have come up and have cropped up is this, that where it has been said that as far as an attempt is concerned, an attempt would be the penultimate act before the commission of an offense. Now, what do we mean by a penultimate act? A penultimate act means an act which is one but the last. So that stage will be a punishable stage. But acts which are not penultimate in nature will be considered within the pale and ambit of preparation. Now, this is a view which was not accepted by many. This was a view which was propounded by many and a view which was not accepted by many. Because the more accepted view was that yes, there are a series of acts which go to the commission of an offense. But all those series of acts which further the intention which has been nursed, that could be said to be comprising the offense of an attempt. It is not the penultimate act. The test cannot be that of the last act. It can be any one of those acts which furthers the intention, the original intention to commit an offense. So there is a difference and divergence in view as far as that is concerned. And that I will deal with attempt as it is. An entire section on attempt is what we will deal with on the next session that we have. We will end today's session with these two stages that we discussed thoroughly. The next will be an entire session on attempt. So with that, I sign off. Thank you very much for being there. Good day.